So hello everyone, thank you for joining. I see here we have paper 145, Mr. Mustafa Sengildiz. This is the first presenter. We also have 7861, okay, 6. So we're only missing the last one, Mr. Hasan Gündoğdu or Mr. Baslan Demirci. Okay. Okay. Mr. Baslan Demirci is also here now. Okay. So I think we can start now. We have all the paper representatives here. First, it's paper number 145. Its title is Cascaded Clustering Analysis of Electricity Load Profile Based on Smart Metering Data. Okay, interesting one. With us here is Mr. Mustafa Sengildiz. Mr. Sengildiz, please tell us something about you, and also you can share your screen also.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a minute. Can you see my slide? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can hear you, yes.
Good afternoon, panelists and attendees. My name is Mustafa Sengildiz. I am the PhD student, Department of Electrical Engineering in Yıldız Technical University, and I am working as a research assistant in Kırklareli University. My presentation is Cascaded Clustering Analysis of Electricity Load Profile Based on Smart Metering Data. My presentation flow, introduction step, proposed methodology slides, case study, and results. Introduction slides give a brief information about the subject. The proposed methodology slides provides general and brief information about the clustering methodology and the differences of the study. Third one, the case study section, we have different case studies about the determining the consumer characteristics and the clustering these consumers' data. Results and discussion slides in the last part of the presentation evaluate the results. In the transition from the traditional to modern power systems, the most intense evolutions have been experienced at the distribution level. Integration of communication technologies and smart metering to the network is made the distribution networks have advanced by having higher observability and infrastructure suitable for the bidirectional data stream, which enables interaction with the consumer. Thus, passive distribution networks that only allow consumption activities in traditional power systems have become an active system where users can participate in the operation. Load data log by smart metering is very important information for system operators. This data is used in studies such as system planning, demand forecasting, demand management, and dynamic pricing. Also, this data supports outage management and increases the grid reliability. To analyze the data set using data mining techniques gives information about the potential state of the power system. The clustering, one of these data mining techniques, is unsupervised technique for segmentation a data set. Through this technique, consumer trends and consumption behaviors can be analyzed. In this study, a cascaded clustering method format with the K-Meroids algorithm has been proposed. The figure, bottom of the page, is our study. At first, collected the data by smart metering systems, and then preprocessed. After the preprocessing process continues with the determination of characteristic features for each consumer. In other words, typical load profile, clustering, and extraction of representative load profile. Determination of the typical load profile is the first level. Proposed cascaded algorithm, the data of consumer in the data set is clustered. Thus, instead of separating the data with criteria that can't be defined precisely, such as seasonality and consumer type, the decomposition is provided by considering the values in the data set directly. At the second level, the clusters obtained in the first level are assigned the two common clusters with similar consumption behaviors of different consumers by reclustering. Our methodology, the characteristics of the data sets and the variance level of the consumption profiles in the data are effectively consumption profiles in the data are effective in the algorithm preferences. Besides, the ease of application of the method to the data set is also important. In this study, the K-Meroid clustering algorithm, which is a partitional algorithm, has been preferred. As in all partitioning clustering algorithm, the key value, which expresses the optimum number of clusters, must be predetermined in the K-Meroid's algorithm. Working with a high number of clusters increases the number of parameters and the computational efforts, while working with a low number of clusters reduces the consistency. Therefore, it's important to determine the optimum number of clusters for the success of clustering analysis. In this study, the elbow method has been used. However, an analytical approach has been adopted rather than the graphical approach, which is widely used in the literature. The flow of the adapted elbow method approach has been given in the figure, that figure. In the first step of the elbow method, the minimum and maximum values for the number of clusters are decided. In this study, these values are the minimum K value is 2 and maximum K value is 40. It's experimental values. For each K value, clustering is performed and the sum of squared error is calculated with this step. By calculating the difference between SSCs for consecutive K values, the rate of SSCs change, this delta SSC versus the increase on K values is obtained. The difference between successive double delta SSC gives information about the linearity of this change. A threshold value close to zero is determined for double delta SSC values, the point where linearization starts is determined and the number of clusters to be used is decided. In this study, the threshold value was determined at 0.3. That value was determined as an experimental. If we change the data set, must be analyzed experimentally, threshold value and the minimum and maximum value. It's these three values are experimental value. If we change the data, these values can be changed. The K-meloid algorithm, a version of K-means, K-meloids is a version of K-means algorithm, is a basic but highly functional algorithm. K-meloids or partition around the meloids, it's also PAM algorithm, is an unsupervised partitional machine learning algorithm. The K-meloids algorithm is based on the midoids using the median data point, unlike the K-means algorithm, which is based on the centroids taking the mean value in the selection of the cluster center. Midoid is the object in the cluster that has the minimum average distance from all other objects in the cluster. Thanks to this feature, it produces more accurate results against the data with high variance. It also provides a representation of clusters with real data. If we look into K-meloid algorithm, the function, mathematical function, bottom of the page is where uppercase G is the main function. Lowercase g is the number of clusters. The e, lowercase e, is the number of the data, and the cg is the jth midoid, and xe is the eth data point. Our proposed cascaded K-meloid clustering, cascaded clustering method formed with the K-meloid algorithm has been proposed. In the first step of the algorithm, K-meloids are selected among the objects. The distance of each object to the midoids is calculated and assigned to their cluster of the nearest midoid. In the second step, new midoids of the clusters are determined with the assigned objects. The distance of each object to new midoid is calculated. Objects whose set needs to be changed according to the distance results are assigned to their new sets. The second step is iterated until no object have changed steps. The case study, the raw data we used is 3-4 year data from between 2014 to 2019 with 15 minutes resolution for 370 consumers from different classes. It means residential, commercial, or industrial. 1 year of data is sufficient for the clustering analysis plan to be carried out in the study. Therefore, the year with the least missing and outlier values has been detected, and the remaining data belongs 3 years have been removed from the raw data. Thereafter, consumers with missing and outlier values have been detected and cleaned from our data. In order to reduce the data size, the data resolution from 15 minutes to converted this data to hourly data, have been converted to hourly data, which is mostly preferred in load profile clustering studies in the literature. After the data cleaning and after the, after the data cleaning and reduction steps, a data set with a size of 342 and 365 has been obtained. This number is the consumer load profiles number, and this one the whole years for everyone. 365 days load data. The data set has been normalized in order to make the consumption behaviors. in the data set independent of the size of consumers' facilities. Min-max normalization has been applied to the data set in order to make the consumption behaviors in the data set independent of the size of the customers' facilities. After these pre-processing processes, clustering of the data has been examined for four different cases. In three of these cases, case one, case two, and case three, the data has been sent into the clustering algorithm with different approaches in terms of the data selection and aggregation. In the last case, in the other word, case four, the data set has been directly subjected to the cascading K-Meadows clustering algorithm proposed in the study. Details about the studied cases are given in the table. If we check that table, in case one, the data set has been sent to the clustering algorithm after estimating typical daily load profiles for each consumer. A typical load profile has been created for each consumer by averaging the daily load profiles of each consumer throughout the year. In case two, it has been decomposed the whole data as weekdays and weekends. A typical load profile is created for each consumer by taking the average of the daily profiles of each consumer on weekdays in this step. And also average of the daily profiles of each household consumers on weekends throughout the year. In case three, seasonality effect adding these cases, for these three season, winter, spring and autumn and summer seasons as separated, divided weekdays and weekends and decomposed for six different data set. If we explain the months of the winter season, December, January, and February, and summer season, June, July, and August, and the other 6 months is the spring and autumn segment. The results for these three cases, clustering analysis was performed 9 times. One time in case one, two times in case two, and 6 times in case three. With the help of the elbow method, the optimum number of clusters of each clustering analysis is indicated on the top figure. In case four, the proposed cascade clustering algorithm is directly applied to the data without the need for any prior decomposition or data processing. The decompositions performed by the practitioner in other cases performed in the first level of the proposed cascade algorithm without any need to external interventions. As a result of the clustering performed in the first level of the algorithm, the distribution of objects according to the number of clusters is given in the bottom figure, first level. In the second step, the clusters obtained in the first step are subjected to the K-Meadows clustering algorithm again, and new cluster centers are determined for similar clusters belonging to different objects, and these clusters are assigned to new cluster centers. After the first step, a total of 2,213 clusters have been obtained. For the clustering analysis performed in the second step, the optimum number of clusters has been determined as 27 with the help of the elbow method. Cluster centers produced as a result of clustering has been used as RLP representative load profile in order to compare the success of clustering analysis for the studied cases. By using the representative profiles, the synthetic consumption data for a year for each users have been derived by considering the adapted situation of each case. After the clustering analysis for case one, 11 RLP have been obtained. consumption data of each consumer for a year has been created by repeating the representative load profile to which consumer has been assigned 365 times. The move from normalized values to actual values, each consumer has been multiplied by its maximum value. The same approach has been applied for each case, and 1 year synthetic consumption data has been derived for all consumers in all cases. For each case, the RMSE values of all users between synthetic data and real data have been calculated. The RMSE values obtained for each user's four cases have been compared, and it has been examined in which case the lowest RMSE value have been provided. Obtained results have been illustrated in the figure. As can be seen from the figure that the clustering analysis performed with the proposed clustering algorithm has a much higher success than those performed for the other three cases. Out of 342 consumers, 287 had the lowest RMSE value in case four. That means as a very high success.
Mr. Please conclude in 1 minute.
Okay. I'm finishing. Consumption behavior of consumers in power systems is a characteristic feature. The consumption behavior of the same consumer during the year might differ according to the days of the week and the season. Various approach may be adapted to increase the success of the clustering study by decomposing the data to identify the intervals when similar consumption behaviors are exhibited, and by applying the cluster analysis separately to the decomposed data. Considering the number and diversity of consumer in the system, it's very difficult to implement this approach correctly. Consumption behavior of a consumer in the summer months may be similar to the behavior of another consumer in winter months. On the other hand, it's not possible to determine the seasonal intervals accurately. These uncertainties can be avoided with the cascaded clustering algorithm proposed within the scope of the study. In the first level of proposed algorithm, typical load consumption profiles of each user are determined. And the second level, these consumption behaviors are clustered again. Thus, similar consumption behaviors of the different consumer at different time intervals can be assigned to the same cluster center. Thanks for your attention.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Sengildiz. Are there any questions from the audience? Just one question from me. This clustering, I assume, is very useful for the aggregators. I mean, for a company
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
So. Okay. So now let's go to the next presentation. Its title is Energy Loss Minimization with Parallel Implementation of Marine Predators Algorithm. Together with us now is Mr. Sohail Younesi. So the floor is yours.
Yes, sir. Do you have my voice?
Excuse me?
Do you have my voice?
Yes,
we are hearing.
Yes, we hear, yes.
Okay.
You can share your screen. Yeah.
I think you have my screen right now. Okay. Hello, everybody. I am Sohail Younesi, and I am a master's student in the Istanbul Technical University. And today I'm going to present our latest paper with the title of Energy Loss Minimization with Parallel Implementation of Marine Predators Algorithm. First of all, I would like to thank the actually the creators of the conference, especially for the Professor Dimitris and my professor, Professor Aydoğan Özdemir. So first of all, let's see the contents. At the first step, I will introduce the problem that we proposed in actually in our paper. After that, I will present the objective function that we have. And in the third section, we will discuss the marine predators optimization algorithm, actually the parallel form of it. And at the fourth section, the parallel computation indices will be studied. And in the next section, the test system and simulation will be shown. And at the last of the presentation, we will conclude the presentation with the summary and conclusion. So the main objectives in our in this paper, we are going to minimize the active power losses by sizing and allocating the two kind of distributed generators for the network. Actually, we use the solar energy and the wind turbine. It means that the photovoltaics and the wind turbines are used for the penetration. And second objective is the for increasing the speed of the computation in our optimization problem, which means we implemented, we actually imported a technique to parallelize the processors with each other and increase and eventually increase the speed of computation. We use the MATLAB parallel computing lab for the purpose of simulation. Our objective function is a single form of objective, which I'm going to present the objective function in the next slides. The optimization method is the marine predator optimization algorithm, which we changed the way of the optimization by parallelizing the that optimizer. Here we use a model to minimize the active power loss through optimal tuning of the control parameters while satisfying the equality and the inequality constraints. The mathematical formulation is given as follows, where L sub R and S sub R represents the location and the size vectors of the DG units respectively. NT is the total optimization duration in hours, which we take the 72 hours in this study. N bus is the number of buses that exist in the feeder, and resistance of the line between bus J and K is showed by RJK, which appears here, and IJK is the line current between bus J and bus K at hour I. And the P is the penalty factor defined below this P, and the C is the constant balancing the penalty term and the main objective function. Here, actually, Vij denotes the voltage magnitude of bus I at our bus J at our I, actually. In this simulation, we used the forward-backward sweep method because of the unbalanced distributed load, radial configuration of network, and distributed generation in the distribution system line, and high Rx. In this slide, as you can see, I proposed the the flowchart of the parallelizing of the marine predator algorithm. The first row shows the actually the process of the one of the processors. It means that in every for every processor we have a single row here, and we can have rows up to n rows in this flowchart. So in the first line we can see the first processor that initialize of the search agent for itself and calculate load flow equation, update fitness value and for itself, and evaluate search agents, determine best agents. And after that, when the process of optimization reaches the migration points, here is the migration point. At the migration points, the processor sends its best values to the master processor. Master processor selects best solutions among all and returns them to the processors. And if the migration rate number finishes, it finishes the algorithm and stops here and indicate the best solution as the final result. And if you are asking me why you doing such a thing, because in this algorithm, actually in this in the proposed method, if every processor do the optimization process by itself and don't share the results with each other, there is no difference between parallel computing and serial computing, because the other processors will not be able to know what is going on the other processors. So for the sake of doing the optimization processes in the right manner, we make a point in the middle of the optimizing, and we make the processors to communicate with each other. It means that sends their results to the master processor, and then master processor take the best decision and the best results and returns them to the processors. So in the parallel computation, we have two very important and key indices, actually, which one of them is the speed up, as you can see here. Speed up means the computation time in the serial mode divided by the computation time in the parallel mode for the same problem. And the efficiency is the second key important factor, which means this speed up divided by the number of processors. And in the next slides, I will show the results of the speed up and efficiency. So here, as you can see, the speed up curve for our problem appears like this. Why it is like this? Because we decided to run the same problem with two number of processors, with 4 and 6 and 10, 15 and 20 number of processors, which means we have 6 different scenarios here. And in every scenario, as you can see, when we increase the number of processors, the efficiency or the speed of the speed of the computation does not go like an ideal case. And this line, this line is the orange colored line, is the ideal case, which if you can see here, the 10 number of processors, 15 and 20, after a while, between ideal case and their speed up. And respectively, the efficiency curve shows that with the increasing number of processors, the efficiency goes down. So if the speed up is if the efficiency goes down, so we might ask ourselves that if the results is going to be reliable or not. I mean the results of the power system. So before showing the simulation result, I would like to show the 69 bus test system here, because we implemented this proposed method for the 69 bus test system. And this line diagram of the 69 bus test system shows here that, and the results for the serial computing, actually the result of the, as you can see here, for the serial computing. And as you can see, the serial computing penetrate some wind turbine and photovoltaics for the bus number 11, I mean for the green buses, as you can see. And let's actually discuss the results of the parallel computing and show and see how it works. Is it reliable or not? So in this table, as you can see, we have a several number of scenarios here, which is, this one is for the serial computing, that conventional way. And the rest of them is for 2, 4, 6, 10, 50, and 20 number of processors. So in each scenario, as you can see, we have a computation time. So computation time, objective function, locating and sizing output, and total size in kilobyte, total penetrated size, actually. So here in the locating and sizing output, actually the sum of the sizes, some of the penetrated sizes is about 6,290 kilowatts. And in the parallel computing, we must try to reach this number, or we must try to go near to this number. And as you can see, the rest of the computation scenario almost reaches the same number with the with respect to the serial computing. And as you can see here, objective function value, that they are very similar to each other and very close to each other, which means that parallel computing with these techniques can result in a very accurate results with respect to the serial computing, but it can also decrease the computation time drastically. As you can see in the serial computing, the 18,691 second takes to find these results. Actually, these results, I didn't explain them. They are locations and sizes and types. Locations means the bus number, sizes are the size of the penetrated DG, and the type is the wind turbine or photovoltaic. And computation time decreases drastically here with the 2n number of processor. We can simulate the same problem in just 1,032 seconds, which means that the parallel computing, with this technique of parallel computation, we can reach to the very accurate results and very similar results, which means that the parallel computing is quite reliable. So let me.
Dear Mr. Yunusi, you have 2 minutes.
Okay. Yes, okay. The curve of the energy loss reduction, as you can see here, this is the best case losses for the 69 bus test system. And after reduction of the after penetration or allocation of distributed generators, as you can see, our losses decreases very, very actually, it is a great result for the minimization. And as a summary and conclusion, a single form, we use the single form of the objective function for the allocation of the distributed generators. And we implemented parallel million predator optimization algorithm. And we use two very important indices for quantifying or measuring the quality of the parallel computing. And the proposed method implemented to the 69 radial tail system. And the simulation results show that the results were reliable even when we use the high number of processors. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Junesi. Thank you very much.
If there is any.
Yes. Are there any questions from the attendees, from the audience? I don't see anything. I have basically a question at the you have shown to us a formula. I think at the slide number three, I think. It's the basic formula. This one, yes. I have two questions here. First one, the voltage Vij, I assume that is in per unit, right?
Yes, they are in per unit.
Yes, okay. Also, here you imply that actually the active power is directly, let's say, analogous, dielectric, analogous to the square of the deviation of the voltage from 0.95. This formula here, did you invent it or did you find it at another? It's a classical formula that you found in another book or another paper.
Actually, it is the penalty function. Optimization problems, we use penalty function to balance the formulation, the result of the formulation. Okay. When it goes to the upper of the, for example, 1.05, we subtract it with the 1.05 to decrease the cut that actually out goings.
Okay. So you want to minimize also the penalties?
Yes.
Not only the power losses, but also the. Okay.
Yeah, it is a general formulation. We used in our latest paper, we used it for the. A minimization of the voltage, actually.
Okay.
You are right, it can be used.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
So now the next paper titled is Comparison of Real-Time Voltage Stability Assessment Methods. Here we have with us Mr. Malik Bilgen. So Mr. Bilgen, the floor is yours.
Hello, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Can you screen my, can you see my
yes,
screen?
Yes.
Thank you. Wait a minute. Hello, my name is Melih Bilgen. I graduated from Middle East Technical University at 2015, and I am now a master's student at Gazi University. The title of our paper is Comparison of Real-Time Voltage Stability Assessment Methods. I wrote this paper with Mr. Şaban Özdemir, who is professor at Gazi University. The paper compares four Thevenin equivalent base methods for real-time voltage stability assessment. Performance and evaluation of the methods are carried out for two cases. Both noise-free and noisy data are used to measure the efficiency of the methods in real environment conditions. Here is the outline. After the introduction part, I will mention about real-time voltage stability assessment methods. Then I will examine Thevenin-Ecolon-based methods deeply. And lastly, I will mention about cases and results of the chosen methods. So voltage unbalance and voltage collapse were often considered to be a problem of power systems with long transmission lines. However, ensuring voltage stability has become one of the most important challenges in today's power system operation due to high penetration of renewable energy sources to the grid, and they couldn't provide reactive power support to the grid as much as conventional power plants do. Also, integration of electrical vehicles is a major concern in today's grid. Thus, safe, flexible, and stable operation of the electrical network has become more challenging. Power system stability can be divided into three categories. These are angle stability, frequency stability, and voltage stability. We focus on voltage stability for large disturbances. So the mechanism of the real-time voltage stability assessment can be summarized in five steps. The first step is to take a snapshot of a power system. Then we develop a suitable network model. And in the third step, we perform the analysis. Then we report them. And the last step is raise alarms when security issues are detected. The key feature of real-time operation is time. Time is very crucial. Time is more crucial than accuracy. Also, accuracy is desired also. So the most widely used system to monitor the grid is SCADA, but it cannot perform real-time measurements and its sampling rate is low. It is necessary to monitor the system in real time in order to quickly control the dynamic and the static situations caused by voltage collapse. Phasor measurement unit is a fairly new technology that can meet these needs. So my second topic is real-time voltage stability assessment methods. Voltage stability assessment methods can be broadly grouped into two categories. These are the methods based on local measurements and the methods based on wider measurements. Local one has no dependency on other measurements. On the other hand, wide area gives more accurate results than the local one. However, full observability is required for the wide area since it is not yet possible to fully observe a power system. This paper focused on the methods based on local measurements. Local measurements can also be divided into four categories. These are machine learning-based methods, energy functions-based methods, static methods, and Thevenin-Ecolon circuit-based methods. So machine learning-based methods use raw data as input, then train and test data to generate a logical output. They require full observability of the system, and all possible scenarios should be defined for the training process. Energy function-based methods reduce all power system to one machine and one bus, and that is called as single machine infinite bus. And they calculate voltage margin according to predetermined critical energy by using energy functions, such as Lyapunov energy function. And they have some difficulties, such as reducing the system to single machine infinite bus equivalent and determining the critical energy. So what about static methods? Their computational time is longer compared to other methods in order to calculate voltage stability margin, since the model contains high degree of mathematical models of the electrical equipment. The last one is Thevenin-Ecolon circuit-based methods. They are considered as one of the most prominent of all method types since they are fast and their accuracy is high. Also, they are used both in local and wide area voltage stability assessments. Therefore, only Thevenin-Ecolon-based methods are studied in this paper. So basically, any power system could be shown by using a load bus, an impedance, and a voltage source. maximum power transfer will occur when Thevenin impedance and the load impedance are equal. We chose four prominent Thevenin-based methods. These are ordinarily square method, Telegen's theorem-based method, adaptive method, and Kadar-Marov method. So the first one is ordinarily square method. We can write Thevenin voltage as the sum of the load voltage and the Thevenin impedance multiplied by load current as shown in equation one. Also, each term of the equation can be written in Cartesian form as shown in equation two. Also, it is possible to convert equation one into a matrix form as shown equation three. Here, X has four unknowns and B has two unknown, B has two known variables. Therefore, at least two measurements are needed to solve this equation. However, in order to eliminate noise data, four measurements are taken in each iteration. M is here, is the number of measurement sets. Since M is more than two, the matrix will become overdetermined. Thus, the method tries to find a best fit curve by minimizing sum of squared perpendicular distances with respect to x. The problem of minimizations has a single solution as shown in equation four. The second one is Telegen's theorem based method. The theorem states that sum of instantaneous power absorbed by all the elements in all branches of a power system is zero at any time. Due to time limitation, I couldn't explain the entire process, but I could tell that the method calculates Thevenin impedance by observing change in load current and bus voltages as shown equation six. So the third method is adaptive method. Adaptive method neglects R Thevenin since at high voltage level, X is much greater than R. Therefore, we are okay to neglect R Thevenin. Therefore, equation seven could be split into two parts as shown in equation eight. Since there are two equations and three unknowns, it's not possible to solve this equation, but initial estimation of Thevenin voltage can help to find a solution. Initial Thevenin voltage is the average of maximum and minimum Thevenin voltages. After that, the algorithm updates the initial guess towards the correct value. And the last method is Kadar-Marov method. The method states that it is possible to write equation 11. In order to solve this, three consecutive measurements are collected. After some mathematical operations, we get equation 12. Three measurements are enough to solve this equation, but taking three measurements has some risks. Therefore, the method suggests that taking more consecutive measurements. So in this paper, we take five consecutive measurements. The algorithm can be summarized in three steps. The first step is to take five consecutive measurements and using three of these measurements to create 10 triples. In step two, creating pairs by using 10 triples, we get 45 different Thevenin impedance parameters by using these pairs, R and X. And in step three, we determine R and X by employing frequency distribution. They are selected according to most frequent range in the distribution. After that, Thevenin voltage is determined. Two cases are prepared to measure performance of the methods. Measurements are taken by using time domain simulation tool of power factory, Dixon power factory. PMU sampling rate is 20 samples per second. The methods are tested on 14 bus system for case one. The system has 14 buses, 5 generators, 11 loads, etc. All loads are continuously increased at the rate of about 15 megawatt per second and 0.5 MVAR per second for 15 seconds, starting from t is equal to 12 seconds to t is equal to 27 seconds. The aim is observing voltage collapse by increasing all loads as a ramp function. Bus 4 and bus 13 are selected as monitored buses. They are in red circles. Upper figure shows that voltages started to decrease at t is equal to 12 seconds and dramatically decreased after 30 seconds. And the lower figure shows that maximum power transfer occurs at 17.87 seconds for bus 4 and 15.6 seconds for bus 13. The methods are expected to detect voltage instability immediately after MPT occurs. The results of the methods for bus 4 are shown in the figures. OLS, ordinally square method, estimated Thevenin and load impedances become equal at t is equal to 18 seconds. Thevenin impedance fluctuated higher for noisy case until t is equal to 12 seconds, but it doesn't cause any alarm in the system since the load impedance is always bigger than the Thevenin impedance in this period. Telegen's theorem or TT estimated voltage collapse at earlier than 80 seconds. It is seen that the performance of the method for noisy case is almost same as noise-free case. Thevenin impedance calculated by adaptive method or AD are getting lower up to t is equal to 12 seconds. After this time, Thevenin impedance matches the load impedance at t is equal to 27 seconds. Thus, it can be said that adaptive method detects voltage instability later than the time estimated by previous methods. The performance of Kadar-Morov is the worst performance since Thevenin impedances oscillates with large amplitudes. These oscillations may lead to wrong warning that voltage collapse will occur. The results of the bus 13 are shown in the figures. We get similar performances from the methods, ordinary least square and Telegen's theorem-based methods have good performances to estimate voltage instability. Adaptive performance is worse than these two, but better than Kadar-Morov method. So this time the methods are tested on 39 bus New England system. The loads again are continuously increased at the rate of 6 megawatt per second and 1.4 MVAR per second for 100 seconds, starting from t is equal to 5 seconds to t is equal to 105 seconds, 5 seconds. After that, the loss continues to increase with different rates from t is equal to 105 seconds to t is equal to 120 seconds. Here, bus 39 is selected as monitored bus. MPT occurred at t is equal to 115.4 seconds for bus 39. Method results are shown in the figures. OLS detected Thevenin impedance is equal to load impedance at t is equal to 116.5 seconds here, which indicates that the performance of OLS is quite good. OLS also shows good performance for noise data. Telegen's theorem based TT method estimated Thevenin impedance catches the load impedance at 115.5 seconds, but the Thevenin impedance oscillates with very large amplitude and Thevenin impedance is on lower side of the load curve many times after 120 seconds. Adaptive method initially calculated the Thevenin impedance a little bit high, above 0.5 per unit. The method estimated that voltage would collapse at T is equal to 120 seconds without any oscillation, by the way. While adaptive method shows similar performances for both noise-free and noisy cases, Kadar-Merrill method calculated the Thevenin impedance with high oscillations as in the previous scenario for both noise-free and noisy cases. Numerical results of the methods for both cases here. Although the performance of adaptive method is not affected by noise and its performance is better than Kadar-Merrill method, it detected voltage instability with time delay. Ordinary least square and Telegen's theorem based methods detected voltage instability instantly. In addition, they are minimally affected by noise. So therefore it's concluded that these methods are suitable for practical power systems. And this brings me end of to my presentation. Thank you for listening to me. If you have any questions, I'm glad to answer them.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Bilgin. Very interesting presentation. I just wanted to ask one thing. You mentioned in your presentation that, I don't remember exactly where, that R, the ohmic R is much lower or bigger than X, the reactance?
At high voltage level, X is much greater than R.
Okay, yes, you're right. Okay, thank you very much. Are there any questions from the audience? Okay, nothing. So thank you again.
Thank you.
So now let's go to presentation paper number 61, technical comparison of PWM and MPPT charge regulators. Here with us is Mr. Said Mirza Terkan, right?
Yes.
Okay, so the floor is yours.
Do you hear me? Do you hear me, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, we hear you. Yes.
First of all, I apologize. My sound is not good. I'm because of the sequences. Do you see my presentation?
Yes, we see it.
First of all, hello to everyone. My name is Said Mirza Terkan from Tiflis Technical University, on the Department of Electrical Engineering. I will present technical comparison of PWM and MPPT charge regulators. We prepared this work with Ahmet Yılmaz and Alparslan Demirci. My presentation plan like this. First of all, I will summarize briefly the common charge control methods, such as custom current, custom voltage, and three-state charging techniques. And I will compare these techniques. Secondly, I will describe another commonly used perturbation observed method using MPPT, using in maximum power point trackers. And third, I will compare perturbation observed and three-stage charging technique under fixed and varying radiation. And finally, I conclude this study. There has been a rapid trend towards green energy sources worldwide, including wind, wave, biogas and solar due to the insufficiency of the and healthy tendency of fossil fuels. Solar energy is mostly preferred due to the easier access, lower investment costs, and having less risk. Small and large-scale solar power plants have been installed consisting of PV panels, energy storage system, and charge controllers. Charge controllers such as tools for engine modulation, PWM or MPPTs can extend of expensive battery lifespan. PWM method can charge battery with low current than maximum power point of the panel, because the maximum power point of the PV panel depends on weather condition. So the constant current to the charge the batteries from the PV panel cannot be provided continuously. For this reason, the battery should be sized according to the available average capacitor current that can be drawn from the panel. On the other hand, MPPT method uses PV panels efficiently rather than the battery. PWM techniques have several issues like higher price at low power, while MPPT techniques are more complex than PWM. As you can see the screen, photovoltaic cells use PN junction semiconductors to observe and convert light energy into electrical energy. Solar energy can be directly converted into electric energy by this method. PV modules are formed by connecting many series and parallel cells. A PV cell consists of a current source, a diode, parallel terms, and series and parallel resistance as shown in figure. Skipping the mathematical equation of PV model, a general characteristic of PV panels are given in table and figures that we use in this work, in this study. Charge control methods, PVM and PPD are used global charge control method. PWM is cheaper, generally preferred at low power. MPPT is expensive, but preferred at medium and higher power values. The most common MPPT technique is the perturb and absorb technique. Main three types of PWM techniques are constant current, constant current, constant voltage, and three-state charging techniques. Constant current charging techniques is a simple one. Battery is charged with the constant current until the desired voltage is obtained. Constant current, constant voltage is a little difference. Constant current charge starts with constant current and then ended with a very low current. Reaching the desired charge voltage. Three-stage charging technique with start with a middle constant current and after the threshold voltage one, the current increase and the end current at end the charging process is decreased. The shortening charging time may reduce battery lifespan due to the uncompleted charge. Therefore, constant current and constant voltage technique was developed to charge battery fully with modest current at the end of the charge and harvest more energy from the PV panel. The three-state charging method is very similar to custom current, custom voltage. The only difference is an intermediate threshold voltage. Thus, eliminating high custom current elevates battery efficiency. It is a suitable PWM charging technique. Perturb and absorb is one of the most well-known techniques among MPPT methods. Perturb and absorb is preferred mostly due to the simplicity and not allowing oscillating at maximum power point. The working principle is based on custom current. The voltage increases if power larger than the previous, or the power decreases while voltage increases, the voltage should be decreased. As you can see, the MATLAB simulating model of Perturban Observer. The comparison Perturban Observer and three-stage PEM. Perturban Observer is more efficient, but PEM charge controllers are 3.5 or 5 times more expensive than PEM charge controllers, according to the prices that we can access from the internet. As a result of the study, that using a small power MPPT charge regulate charge controllers is not economical due to the higher cost, approximately 4 times. The cost of PEM and MPPT are discussed based on the simulation using the radiation measure at Yavuzteknin University on 21 September 2019, summarizing a cloudy and a clear day with customs 1000 watt per meter square radiation at 25 degree constant temperature. We use this measured data. You can see the data. The first left one is measured, and the right one is average radiation data. We use this data in simulation. The 100 samples, 1,000 samples. At a custom 25 degree temperature for only 60 seconds, 0.60 seconds. Power transferred in this simulation, power transferred from the TV panel to the load using three-stage PVM and Perturban Observer at steady state is 138.8 watt and 151.7 watt respectively. The power can be transferred from the panel at 100% efficiency, 164.8 watt. Efficiencies of the Perturban Observer and TUM are respectively 92% and 84%. The difference only approximately 8% efficiency. We again simulate these PVM and MPPT under varying radiations. Radiations changed, but average of this radiation 508 watt per meter square radiation and a custom 25 degrees temperature. In the simulation under varying condition, power transferred to the load using 3-stage PVM 38.8 watt and Perturban Observer 66.5 watt. If we can draw at we can draw 84 watt with 100% efficiency. The efficiencies of PVM and Perturban Observer are 46.6% and 79% for efficiency. So MPPT regulators are superior to PVM regulators, especially in cloud movement, cloudy days. If the number of cloudy days are more than clear days, MPPT should be preferred for charge controller. The table summarizes the performance of PVM and MPPT charging techniques. under clear sky, under clear days, power can be drawn from PV panels, and efficiency of MPPT is higher than PVM. But partly cloudy days, power can be drawn from panel, and efficiency is higher than, or again, PVM for the PVM charging techniques. The performance and cost of solar charge control method were compared. MPPT controls are more efficient than PVM controls on clear and particular days, approximately 8% and 33% respectively. However, the cost of MPPT charge controls are approximately 3 times more expensive than PVM controls. Therefore, a PVM charge controller is a more economical option than an MPPT charge controller. But there is a second option is to buy a second PV panel instead of an MPPT charge regulator, especially in an area where most days are clear sky. However, MPPT charge controllers are an economical option for efficient energy harvesting in a region with many partly cloudy days if PV installed power is more than 300 watts and depreciation period assumes less than 10 years. We plan compare the performance of MPPT using net heuristic algorithms in the future works. Thank you for your listening, your attendance.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Terkan. Are there any questions in the audience? No.
I'm sorry for my sound.
Any questions? Anyway, it was an interesting presentation because I didn't realize that in cloudy days, the performance of PWM is techno-economically better. To me,
I'll share the screen again.
Yes.
Okay. The performance is less than MPPT. Look at again the performance table. PVM performance is less than MPPT because MPPT has a stronger tool to catch the maximum power, but it's very expensive than the PVM.
Yes. That's why I said techno-economically. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now,
never mind.
For the final paper now,
thank you.
Performance comparison of Gray Wolf and Perturbative Observed MPPT algorithms in different weather conditions. We have here with us Mr. Alpraslan Demirci. Mr. Demirci, the floor is yours.
Hello, everyone. My name is Alpaslan Demirci from Yıldız Technical University. I will present performance comparison of Gray Wolf and Perturb Observe MPPT algorithms in different weather conditions. My presentation plan can be seen in the screen. Firstly, I will explain the aim and importance of the study. Secondly, I will give the details of modeling of PV system, Perturb Observe MPPT technique, and Gray Wolf algorithm. Thirdly, simulation results, and finally, the conclusion. the aim and importance of the study. Energy demand increased rapidly due to technological and industrial developments and population growth. Seeking toward alternative green energy source has increased due to the gradual decrease of fossil fuel resource and their environment hazard. Unlike fossil fuels, solar energy can be converted using PV panels into electrical energy without polluting the environment. The efficiency is still on the focus of studies. Even solar energy is an endless green energy source. Many studies have dealt with to improve the panel efficiency using algorithm in maximum power point tracker. Such algorithms control DC-DC converters to keep the output voltage of PV panel at the maximum power point so as to harvest maximum energy regardless of weather conditions. We compared the common successful algorithms using in the MPPT. Figure shows the MPPT parts of the single state grid connected PV system. Namely, it illustrates the role of MPPT in overall PV system with smart grid. Modeling of PV system, there are numerous PV models based on the equivalent circuit of single diode and two diode. We preferred the most popular single diode equivalent circuit in our study due to successfulness and ease of applicability. Pertub and Observe is one of the widely used because it is easy to apply and finds the MPP quickly under normal condition. The panel power is calculated by monitoring the voltage and current at the panel output. Then the panel's voltage is decreased or increased by adjusting the duty ratio monitoring change in power. If the panel power is increased, the voltage and duty ratio are changed in the same direction and vice versa. As can be seen in the left figure, the DC-DC converter duty ratio is changed with specific steps until the panel power reaches MPP. A simplified flowchart of Pertub Observe optimization algorithm can be seen. Meteoristic algorithms were needed due to the inability of analytical method to solve complex problems. Gray wolf optimization is preferred among these meteoristic algorithms due to its success. The gray wolf optimization algorithm mimics the leadership, hierarchy, and hunting mechanism of gray wolves in nature. The best solution found in gray wolf optimization are rated as alpha, beta, and delta wolves, respectively. If the iteration is kept high in the algorithm that works for the number of iterations determined by the user, the optimum solution is approach more. However, the running time of the algorithm is longer. For this reason, in the gray wolf algorithm use, the number of iterations should be determined according to the use of the algorithm and the difficulty of the problem to be solved. Always searching throughout the iteration update their position relative to those higher in the hierarchical order, resulting in the best solution. The position update process is performed with the formulas given in equations. Simulation results and discussion. Theoretical model of PV panels were created using the PVLib library and new and flexible modeling Python environment. Algorithm performance have been evaluated on the DC-DC step-down converter built by using the PySpice Python library as shown in figure. We aim to compare performance of meteoristic gray wolf and analytical based Pertub and Observe algorithms in MPPT under rapidly varying radiation and partial shading condition. The characteristic PV and IV curves obtained under standard and partial shading test conditions generated using PVLib Python program are shown in figure. The PV and IV curves related to the clear sky condition and the partial shading condition models created considering 0, 30, 90% shading. Partial shading clearly reduced maximum power of the panel, although figure B shows the highest current in the first step under partial shading. Only local MPP occurred here because the voltage value was low in the third step of VI. Although the voltage increased, the current decreased, so this point is also a local MPP. Global MPP occurs in the knee region of the second step because the power is highest. In order to compare the performance of the algorithms, the theoretical model created at 25 centigrade constant temperature and different radiation appears in the figure. Figure shows the voltage current graph of the partial shading condition model created step by step according to the person shading on the panels. MPP occurred within three steps in the knee regions of the IV curve. However, two of three points are local MPP and one is only a global MPP. If the MPPT control algorithms are stuck in local MPP under partial shading condition, losses may occur in the energy harvest in high power solar power plants. Therefore, new optimization algorithms have developed for finding global MPP quickly responding to weather change. In order to compare the performance of the algorithms, the theoretical model created under constant radiations and different temperature appears in the figure. If we compare the graphs with the previous figure, it's seen that this time the change in maximum power remained at low levels and the change in the voltage MPP value was high. As a result, it has been determined that the change in radiation generally change the curves in the vertical direction and the curves change horizontally with the temperature change. The numerical values of the critical points in the characteristics curves of the solar panel models given the previous two graphs are as in table. Table one. When table one is examined again, it will be seen that the ratio of local to global MPP is around 64%. In fact, this value gives an idea of the average perturb and observe efficiency in the case of partial shading condition. Additionally, the perturb observe algorithm stacks in the local MPP. However, it has been observed that gray wolf optimization does not encounter such a problem and maintains its efficiency values. Algorithm performance compressions under different radiations and 25 centigrade constant temperature are shown in figure. Both algorithms are successful at acceptable levels in terms of runtime and efficiency obtained in the case of clear sky condition. Although the perturb observe algorithm works faster than the meteoristic gray wolf optimization algorithm, it has lower performance in terms of efficiency. Performance of particle shading condition model shows that the efficiency of the perturb observe algorithm has decreased significantly compared to the results obtained in the clear sky condition. This is because the analytical based perturb observe algorithm stacks in the local MPP. The numerical values of the critical points in the characteristic curves of the solar panel models given in the previous two graphs are as in table. In the table, in the case of particle shading condition at 35 centigrade, the efficiency of the gray wave optimization algorithm was around 99%, while the perturb observer technique remained at around 65%, while the solution time of the gray wave optimization algorithm is 147 seconds, it finds a solution is only 0.07 seconds in the perturb observer technique. Conclusion: in this study, the performance of perturb observe and analytical based MPPT method and meteoristic gray wave optimization algorithm were compared under variable radiation and temperature. DC converter is controlled with algorithms, and MPPT has been successfully run in the PySpice Python environment. In the case of clear sky condition, it has been observed that both algorithms are successful in terms of working time and efficiency. However, the analytical technique perturb observe, although faster than gray wolf, performed poorly in terms of efficiency. Moreover, in the results obtained from the test using the partial shading condition model, it was seen that the perturb observe algorithm was stuck in local MPP, and this station significantly reduced the system efficiency. Gray wave optimization, on the other hand, did not encounter such a problem and preserve its efficiency values. As a result, when the success of the algorithms run in all scenarios is examined, it has been determined that the gray wave optimization algorithm performs much better than perturb observe in general. In the future studies, slower solution times of meteoristic algorithms can be accelerated with artificial neural network. Faster and more precise result can be obtained in global MPP. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. De Mercy. Any questions from the audience? Okay. So thank you very much, all of you. To me, all five presentations were very interesting. The last two were similar regarding the topic. So, thank you very much, and hope to see you in 2 years from close, not from distance. The first time that this
conference was done. Yes, I will. I hope to. Yes. Also.
So, thank you all, and have a nice evening. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Have a nice night.
Thank you. Good evening.
Yes, thanks.